866.
Women no longer required to bring male guardian to Hajj and Umrah. Saudi Arabia has made the historic decision to allow women to attend the Hajj and Umrah pilgrimages without a mahram or male guardian. Speaking at the Saudi embassy in Cairo, Tawfiq Al Rabiah, who we know, former minister of commerce, quite capable guy, also former minister of health, currently Saudi Arabia's minister of Hajj and Umrah, said, quote, a woman can come to the kingdom to perform Umrah without a mahram, unquote. The announcement ends a decades-long rule imposed by Saudi Arabia, although exemptions have been given to females attending the Hajj or Umrah pilgrimage with large groups of other women.
Yeah, this is a small step for women in Saudi Arabia. It's also a small step for men in Saudi Arabia. If they, you know, don't want to go and don't want to be the mahram, then they don't have to, which is cool. You know, this isn't going to get a lot of press, Richard, but this is, you know, this is significant, and this is significantly impactful for some who, you know, don't have a mahram that's physically able, or there's a lot of stuff going on. So it's this is very cool. Yeah, Dr. Tawfiq Al Rabiah is a really brilliant guy and in a good spot here with the Ministry of Hajj and Umrah. But yeah, this is interesting.
It is. And people will focus on the human rights aspect of this. It's a good one. It's important and that sort of thing. But there's also Saudi Arabia is trying to make set up an environment where doing the Hajj or Umrah is much easier. I mean, they've centralized their booking through the Nusk, and they've got some new digital platforms. They're trying to really formalize and rationalize and make things easier if you want to book a trip and get there and stay. This is a big impediment. So 50% of the, you know, 50% of the Muslim population, you know, you can't just go, all right, I need to find a date. I need to earn some money, set aside some money to do this trip that's extremely meaningful to me. And oh, by the way, I have to find a guardian or someone to go along with me, which just complicates it even more. So for, you know, the world, it makes it much easier to get there. I think it's important to point out that in Saudi Arabia in 2019, so what, 3 years ago, women, you know, were given the permission. They no longer needed the permission of a male guardian to travel, you know, so that this really doesn't apply so much to Saudi women. It applies more to Muslim women all over the world. And it's an important step.
We talked recently, Richard, I think it was either last week or the week before, about using AI in the Hajj and Umrah to sort of make it a better experience for all of those doing it. And, you know, it's just little changes like this along the way, incremental stuff that is going to add up to a much better experience, like you just described, than maybe in 2015 or 2014, when it was just like, you know, I mean, a very big ordeal to do. So a lot of investment going into that. And it's good to see this. It's also interesting that he made the sort of announcement, very straightforward announcement, from the Saudi embassy in Cairo, which I guess he was visiting for professional reasons, but just an interesting story here. So
It'll be interesting too. You know, a lot of the AI and other things is they're trying to make the experience safer. So they're, you know, understanding traffic flows and managing crowds and any number of things that AI might give you a leg up on. If you eliminate the mahram, that also adds a security aspect that you have to be alert to. So you've got a lot of unaccompanied women in the midst, let's say if it's a Hajj, 2.5 million. But if it's the Umrah and the Hajj over the course of the year, it's 8 to 10 million. So you've got a lot of unaccompanied women you have to make sure are safe. And, you know, and they can have an experience that without feeling threatened or harried or harassed or anything, because it's not, you know, in this milieu, it's not just Saudis, it's from people from all over the world. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some pilgrims, even though it's a important religious and spiritual event, you know, may interact with women unaccompanied women in a way that's not acceptable. So anyway, I guess what I'm saying is any decision has consequences. So, you know, as opposed now to a woman who might be coming with their brother, their husband, their son, they're now unaccompanied. Mm-hmm. And you have to make sure they're safe and they feel safe. especially because this is, you know, if you want to make the Umrah, Hajj and Umrah really attractive and have more people come, you need to make sure your public relations and you can't have bad events or bad reporting or things that go wrong. You really want to be alert to that. So anyway, all I'm saying is any little decision has other consequences. This is a big decision. It'll have big ramifications, and I'm sure they'll address it. I'm sure they're aware of it.
Yeah. And Richard, this transitions to the next yellow number two very well, but I don't know if you've seen the documentaries on Netflix on Woodstock, I think 69 and Woodstock, specifically Woodstock 99.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. I actually watched it on the flight back a few weeks ago and was just blown away. I mean, managing huge crowds of people is very, very difficult for festivals or concert or not. Man, what a nightmare that was. Still have nightmares watching that. That's not really my scene anyway. The music looked great. The experience looked bad. So yeah, I mean, Saudi does that annually, but with 2.5 million people. So it's kind of amazing.